Welcome to Chok Muay Chats episode 12. I think I'm here with Kieran Keddle, promoter, trainer of people like Charlie Boy Peters, originating from the UK, moving over to North America, and now promoting the Muay Thai World Cup and the Road to One series in Canada. So, Kieran, thanks for being on the podcast. I really appreciate it.
No, thank you. I've actually, you know, obviously I reached out to you because I saw some of your great work and I love what you're doing. And you've interviewed a few English guys too, which I thought was really cool. And you seem to be really happening with what's going on in Thailand and a big boom that's happened over the last, 12 months, say, you know, over there with gyms and promotions and, you know. So, I'm honoured to be on it.
Oh, thank you, mate. Thank you. Yeah, I've been here for a while. You know, I've worked closely with Matt Lucas on Fairtex Fight. So one of your actual alumni, Elisa Kick, she's fought on there a couple of times. Very familiar with some of your training. Yeah, so Les Keck, you know, she's very forward, entertaining style. How long did she train with you over in Canada?
Yeah, you know what? Not long. I've got to be honest with you. So she turned up and she sort of developed because she was, she fought in a couple of what they call over here smokers, like these light interviews, just to get some experience. And to be honest with you, she was, she's doing okay. And I was like, okay, let's see what this girl's all about. And I remember her, she was 16 and she got her first actual fight. And we were a little bit worried because she was still very much a girl then, you know, generally developed into the woman and the strength, which she's still developing into now. And then she just put on this amazing performance. And I was like, where did that come from? She just destroyed the girl. A local girl in a few rounds, put her away, and all of a sudden she just went on this rise. You know, it just all of a sudden changed. And then she was just getting victory after victory after victory. She really listened. She was early in training. She wouldn't, you know, she'd be after the training, she'd be doing the extra bits. Anything you asked her to do, she would do. She was very one of those receptive type of fighters. And of course, her story is her parents were going to immigrate back to Germany and she was going to go to do a 4-year course of physiotherapy because actually it was going to be cheaper in Germany than it would have been in Canada. And I said, look, how do you fancy doing a year gap? I think you've got the talent, ability, push to go to a gym. And I think Fairtex would suit you. I'm sure you'll agree, Joe. It's very good for females too. You know, there's a lot of other female characters there. So you will be able to spar, move around, get the exposure with these type of girls. And let's see how you do. I think she's had 6 fights. Her last fight, I'm convinced she won. And I think Philip Wong also made a protest and complaint about that. So hopefully there's a rematch about that. But she's done excellent. She's done really good. She's still... She's only 10, 11 fights in, you know, of her career. And she, and to be the place where she is. And bearing in mind in Canada also, they're a few steps behind. They're still trying to catch up with the rest of the world, even America, to be honest with you, because there isn't many events. She's done very good.
Yeah, she's definitely one that I've been keeping my eye on. You know, whenever I commentate on Fairtex, she always brings a really entertaining, forward-pushing style, which is... You know, now that the evolution of Muay Thai, we're starting to see more of that Muay Mat style come through as the more prominent style, and she definitely fit. She's more fitting for that entertainment that you know promoters and the audiences want to see. So yeah, no, it's really great to see the development of females being pushed through now.
I think she's still a few years away, actually. I think she's probably 18 months developing the actual full power. I'd like to see how she gets on if she gets a chance to fight in the 4 ounce gloves too. I think that would really suit her style, you know.
Mm.
But she still needs some more fights, still needs to get the experience, you know, the last minute changes and fight girls that are going to be, you know, very experienced. So she can gain some experience herself.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that's one of those important things for athletes is just getting the rounds in, you know, getting the experience before you take that big step to the next level. Because one of the problems at the moment here in Thailand is there's a lot of guys and girls coming over that haven't done the development stage. So, for example, going out to the country or fighting on the lower end promotions, they immediately want to just jump straight into the entertainment promotions, and they just haven't got the ring IQ or the knowledge of scoring and how to actually fight. They could stand there and bang, but they don't know how to actually fight good, beautiful Muay Thai.
I agree, because a lot of things are getting fast tracked now, you know. Training's getting fast, exposure's getting fast tracked, and let's be honest, you can have 3-4 fights and have 20,000 followers on Facebook or Instagram, and then all of a sudden you think you're Conor McGregor. You know, it's not the case. You still have to learn the ropes, you know. But I think what happens is then when you have mass exposure and you have a lot of you put pressure on yourself, you know, to perform, and all of a sudden you're on the big stage. Well, you shouldn't be on the big stage yet. Exactly like you said, you should be doing those temple shows, those ones out in the country. Go down to Koh Samui, have 3 fights over a couple of weeks just to get that learning experience, right? We are in a, like you said, an evolution period in Thailand over the last 12 months, which is great to see for the sport. But at the same time, certain things need to be held back.
That's one of my great worries about this period, is about whether that grassroots, the grassroots of Muay Thai here in Thailand is going to die out, because everybody's just going to be wanting to jump into the glamour and the glitz of it all, you know? So,
well, I think what will happen is, first of all, I think you're right, but I think what will happen is next is we're going to start seeing divisions in each country for qualifications. For example, like a road to one.
Yeah.
RWS now have got a road to RWS in England. You'll probably see more of them pop up in different countries. You know, so we need development. And the reason why I bought road to one, or decided to do the Road to One tournament in Canada, was purely because I need these guys to have 3 fights to win to get into one championship. Because if you go into one championship straight away with those little gloves, it can turn out to be a nightmare. So I wanted the guys to have, if you're going to win, you've got to have 3 good fights, hard fights, learn, you know, the ropes, because it's a totally different style, as you know. It's completely different. That's what I wanted to do, is like you just said, they're the grassroots, to try and get them to a stage where, okay, I understand completely the Canadians aren't quite up to the level yet. However, if they've got 3 fights with the little gloves, it's going to give them an absolute boost and a bonus and some experience for when they do get into one championship with a contract, that they have some experience with the little gloves. I've found that some of these guys have jumped straight in thinking they're boxers, thinking they're good with punching, but actually they found it very, very difficult, a rocky road.
Yeah, I think, yeah, I mean, the whole little gloves thing is another debate, but one of the things I was interested in asking you was how did you actually come up with the idea for the Road to One series in Canada? Was it just because there was that gap, that there was no bridge for the professionals to come over here, or?
Well, so when I came over 5 years ago, I was always going to promote, and I was thinking, right, I want to bring what I do, because at the time when I came to Canada, I was a partner in, I was actually the creator of the Muay Thai Grand Prix. So I invented the Muay Thai Grand Prix, and we had different partners. And when I left that group, because I came to Canada, I decided to set up the Muay Thai World Cup. Now, when I was with Muay Thai Grand Prix, we set up an allegiance with Lion Fight, who at the time was pretty big. So we did like an entrance to that. We did a tournament for that. We did an entrance to K1 in Japan, but it was the lower weight divisions. So we had a guy that went on to go into the tournament a couple of times. So I was always trying to work corporations, and I always understand and look at the market and try and understand the market. So the first thing I did was, let's get WBC, because everybody in the world knows what the green belt is in fight sports. They knew what the green belt is. So WBC was the first move, and then we made a big announcement with that, and it was really big for Canada that we had WBC here. Then it started to grow, and the idea with WBC was to grow into other provinces, which we're doing next year. So because of COVID, of course, it delayed everything, as you know, in the fight game, it delayed everything by 2.5 years, really. So now we're going into other provinces, and that's spreading around Canada very well now. So that's really good. The next thing I want to do is, I noticed there were some good fighters. And I was like, what can we do to take to the next level? How can we do that? You know, let's approach the guys at one to see if we can do this. Then I noticed there were some road to ones in England. There's been a few others in Eastern Europe too. Why can't we do it in Canada? I felt there was enough in North America, so I have some Americans too. I felt there was enough strength in our groups to create three different weight classes, which I did. It's been a bit of a nightmare, don't get me wrong. We've had some pullouts and some changes, but the whole tournament in general has been amazing. So I always try and look, what can we do to improve our show? And being honest with you, I get bored if it's too stale. If it's too stale, I'm like, just another show. I need some excitement. So let's make it exciting. Let's get the fans excited. Let's get the locals excited. Let's get the fighters excited. And then if you set a target, you know, when I used to compete myself and fight, I always used to dream of, this is what I want to get to. And I felt this would be excellent for fighters, excellent for gyms and coaches, excellent for the growth of Muay Thai in Canada. Well, now we've got a target. So we set it for a year, three shows, and then we develop a story. So now we're down to the finals on November 25th. We've got six fighters. Obviously, three winners are going to go through, but we developed a story, a narrative, you know, through the three shows. And to be honest with you, it's really took not just the city of Calgary, it's took the whole of Canada by storm. Everybody's talking about it. Our pay-per-view numbers are incredible. Our attendances are incredible. We've got sponsors. We're just about to announce a national TV deal. So it just shows the power of one championship, right? So I thought, if I can hook onto this, I know what they bring to the table, but I also know what I can deliver as well to them. So I'm looking forward to the finals. It's going to be good.
No, that's awesome, especially breaking into the North American market where, you know, it's almost like Australia in a sense, but, you know, North America has all the funding. Sport is like a sport is a religion in North America. So if you're able to tap into that market and bridge that gap between, you know, an Eastern sport and bring it to the North Americans, then my hat's off to you, sir, because that is a very tough market to break into, especially in the world of Muay Thai.
Do you know what? You said some words that I use, which is bridge the gap. And you've got to bridge the gap. I love that saying, by the way, bridge the gap. And you're right also about, if a sport is big here, everybody collaborates. We've got sponsors now that have been with us for the last 4 years. And they love the experience of a show. They love understanding who the fighters are. They love learning the sport, which is great. They love seeing WBC, what that is, and they start following WBC, then they start following One Championship, and they start following One Championship fighters. And of course, we brought over some One Championship fighters like Giorgio Petrosi and Nong O, Liam Harrison. So they can see that we're developing and growing, but you're completely right. The sponsorship side, I've never had anything like this. In England, for a sponsor, I might get some free gloves, I might get a free canvas, I might get some T-shirts. Here, they're financially ready to help you and cooperate. And like you said, bridging gaps, right? I felt there was a massive hole in the market. I thought there was massive talent in Canada. And I felt that I could be the person to bring a show here. But of course, it's not just me. I need a team around me, but I also need the fighters to deliver, because it's all good doing a show, but we've all been to great shows, but we've seen terrible fights, you know, sometimes, or people that aren't quite ready. But I feel now, over the last 5 years, we've developed some good skills with those guys that have come over, that have done seminars, with the shows that we've done, with the exposure of WBC, with the junior world check, with junior games that we did 2 summers ago. I think it's really put Canada on the market. It's took 5 years, but it's really getting there. And I think the three winners are going to be strong competition for one championship. The good news is what we've done is I've made sure with Muay Thai World Cup is that the three winners, I'm also going to make sure that they're looked after. That's the big thing. I'm not just going to say you've won, goodbye, look after yourself. I've made sure that, you know, I don't want them to, let's be honest, I don't want them to, one of the guys to win and then first fight Super Lick. That's not happening. You know, I have to be realistic. We have to build relationships. We have to build fighters. We have to build characters. And I think that's the big strength of what I'm going to bring to Canada.
Yeah, and I think that's a really important thing, especially now, is, you know, making sure that we have the ability to develop a fighter and develop a narrative around the fighter, not just throw them in the, you know, in the deep end without a paddle. It's about making sure that there's fair matches and they're not being a tomato can for a superstar, because that can that can happen, and it has happened in the past with other promotions, is, you know, that they've got their protected fighter and then they're just fed cans. So
it's happened on every show, like you name it, it's happened every show, and I understand the business of it, but I don't want my guys to have the experience, you know, like he was a young kid, Nabil, who fought Superlek in his first fight. I thought that was a bad fight for Nabil. You know, he's 18 years old, 19 years old. He's the WBC champion. I thought he's an excellent fighter. Why give him Superlek first fight? Why even accept Superlek? You know, I get the money. I understand the exposure. But sometimes saying no and waiting 2 or 3 months more is well worth it. You know, like, I wouldn't have personally, it's my personal opinion, each to their own. The coach obviously believed that he could do it. I wouldn't have took a fight like that as an example. So if one of my guys wins this tournament, gets a huge fight opportunity, first fight, we've really got to look at it and say, right, do we want to do this? Because this could really hurt your career. You could get severely damaged. Do you want to do that? You know, we've got to be very clever. And like you said earlier, is with the evolution that's happening in Thailand, I don't want this to be too fast-tracked. You know, we want to have a good guy that's in one championship, so 3, 4, 5, 6 years. That'd be nice. I don't want them to do 1 year, they get beat up 3 times, get knocked out 3 times, because, you know, like you said, they're a tomato can. That's not what's going to happen. And I think some guys and some managers have just put their guys into the lion's den when they shouldn't have. You know, that's what I think.
And especially now with the change with the small gloves, like, let's be honest, the 4 ounce gloves, they are game changers, and they can be career starters or they can be career enders. I have no qualms about my opinions with the small gloves. I'm not a massive fan of them, but they can be career enders. You know, so I think people really need to be careful about what direction they choose when they take that avenue to fight in the small gloves.
Well, it suits certain people, let's put it that way. Mm. And if you look at, like, people like, let's talk about Jonathan Haggie.
Mm.
He fights twice a year. It's perfect.
Yes.
He has nice long training camps. He has nice exposure. He gets sponsors along the way. And he gets nice paydays because he doesn't fight too much. He fights twice a year. And to be honest with you, actually, Jonathan's always been that, by the way, even as a junior. And he fought quite limited, actually. But he was always in the gym training, so he was learning. And it's really paid off for him. That's a prime example of it. But I think then you have some guys who have gone in there and probably don't suit the style, you know, maybe go to RWS or, like you said, go to those village shows 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times, then circle back and see how it works for you. You know, I mean, who's a great fighter I really love his style was Danny Rodriguez. And whether it's true or not, I heard that he got offered a big fight in one championship and he turned it down because he wanted to, I'm going to take my time. I'm 24, 25. I'm going to take my time because like you just said there, there can be career ending these fights, right? And you got to get the right fights because those little gloves are such a game changer. And I agree with you on one hand, for someone who's very like an old school guy with the traditional gloves, I'm accepting that it's changing people's lives. Like if you look at Zach Sen, it's brilliant for him. Absolutely amazing.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It is great. But it only suits certain people. But it can. I think it's going to, if you're thinking about being in the sport for a long, long time, you got to be smart with this. You know, you can't have 41 championship fights. You're going to be brain dead, you know. So I think if you look at Danny Rodriguez, he's steps off the gas. I'm going to continue with the RWS fights. It suits my style. Build my name up, and then I'll get into one championship when I want to. You know, that's a really good career move.
Yeah, yeah, and I think that's I think that's a smart way to look at it. You know, maybe at the tail end of your career, go and have those big fights because, you know, exactly like Sexan, superstar of the stadiums and then moving into one championship has made a lot of money for himself and deserves to be paid, you know, those big bonuses and everything because he always puts on a show and he suits that style.
Doesn't he, Jess? To be honest with you, he's a bit of an anomaly because I've never seen anyone like him. And what I mean by that is he gets a beating in round one and he looks weak. He looks nothing. And all of a sudden it's sort of like, right, it's on. And then he gives two rounds of hell to his opponent. It's a weird, that guy's mental, isn't he? Let's be honest, he's fucking mental. That's what he is, because I've never seen anyone like him. He can take so much punishment.
I was speaking to Nico Carrillo the other day at the gym, and we were talking about that Sexan fight that he had in England, and he said that Sexan's got one of the hardest heads he's ever punched. Said it hurt his hand when he punched his head.
Well, that was an amazing fight. If you watch, I'm sure you've seen it, but Nico and Sexan, Nico did the best thing. So Nico, obviously, if you watch his last one championship fights, he's in the pocket, he picks the shots, he's very nice with the pressure, just good pressure, good coach as well, JB Gallagher. But if you watch his fight against Sexan, of course, he's with the 8-ounce gloves, he moves, he kicks, moves, teeps, moves, scores points, moves, because he knows, he's smart. Nico, right? But Nico Carrillo is another one that's being managed brilliantly. I know he's got a big fight coming up as well. I don't think we can announce it, can we? Or anyone can talk about it.
We can't.
But it's a big fight.
I'm actually doing a podcast with JP straight after this.
Well, tell him I said hello.
We'll do.
Yeah.
We'll do.
Yeah, no, Nico, someone brought up, like, I think it was Leapfrog TV talked about Liam Harrison and Tom Haggy. And I'm friends with Liam, and I've known John and his parents. And in fact, my brother was actually the original coach of John. It's not a fight to have anymore. Liam's 38, you know. He's in a place where, you know, like a Sanchai, he can do what he wants. He should be able to have one or two big paydays, walk out, put his gloves in the center of the ring and have an amazing career I look back on. John and Nico is definitely a fight that I think should happen in the next 12, 18 months if the stars align. You know, I think that's a fight that could be amazing. What a fight that would be.
I really, really, as a fan and as a guy that really tried to support Nico and JP's vision, I really hope that fight happens.
I think it will. I mean, if Nico gets past his next acid, let's be honest, it's an acid test of what he's got next. It's an acid test because, you know, obviously we can't say names until they announce it, but it's a big fight. It's a big, big fight. And if you can get past that, I think he's one or two fights away from that happening.
100%.
You know, and that division, that 145-pound division, is ridiculous. It is ridiculous. I mean, Superlek's now going to step into that weight division. It's just mental division.
Now, just moving. Now, you're originally from the UK, and the UK has got a very, very, very strong and healthy Muay Thai scene at the moment.
Yes.
What was the reason for you moving to North America?
Do you know what? There's lots of answers to that one. It's family is always number one.
Yeah.
The truth is, I had a very well-established gym, successful gym, and that was, I've still got friends for life from that, students for life from that, and it was a very, very good gym. I always wanted to leave UK. Even when I was a kid, I was always traveling about. So 17, 18 years old, I always wanted to leave UK. I always felt there was more for me. Each to their own, you know. And I came to Canada in 2015 with Charlie Peters. He had a fight. My uncle lives here too. And I stayed an extra day. We went out to the mountains and I fell in love with the place. And then Charlie Peters turned around to me and went, "You like this place, don't you?" He knew then in 2015. So I think life changes when you have kids, you know, completely, obviously. And I started looking at different things and where I was living and what the lifestyle and what the upbringing would be like for my kids. And 2017, I came over, had a look around, looked at schools, got offered a job. Why not? Let's have a go at this, you know? And it's been rough. It's been up and down because I was here 8-9 months and COVID come. And when you're on a work permit and you have COVID, it was like, oh, because the gym's closed. That's the only thing I can do. I can't do anything. I can't do no DIY. I can't do anything. I'm not a mechanic. I'm useless at anything. I'm good at coaching. I'm good at promoting. That's it. And I was like, what else do I do here? Am I going to have to be an Uber driver or something? You know, like I was. But luckily we got through that. And then, you know, the last 2 years have been amazing. It's an amazing place. And the people are so friendly. I'm not used to. I am now, but I wasn't used to how friendly people are here. They're over-friendly. You know, like, I think English and Australians are pretty similar in some ways where, you know, like, I'll do an example, and I know what your answer would be. You're in your back garden. You've got a fire on, yeah? I was just burning loads of shit because I just bought a house. This guy walks into your garden. What are you thinking? What are you thinking? Exactly what I was. But this guy generally was like, welcome to the neighborhood. And he bought me a 12-pack. Two six-pack. I went, put him down by the fire, right? And we just sat there for hours. He's a friend of mine. And funnily enough, he's upstairs right now. He's actually in my house. He's got his kids over playing with my kids. And he's a friend for life, a great guy. They're just very different. He bought over a six-pack. And when COVID happened, he understood and saw that, you know, what I was trying to do and accomplish in his country. And he helped me out incredibly. And so did the guy that owns a gym and runs a gym, Elite. So is the guy that helped me out with the purchasing of the house. Well, so many people helped me. But like you said, an exact answer was, what the fuck does this guy want? But these Canadians are so nice. And when you went back to, and you said earlier about bridging the gap, these guys have taught me about how to bridge the gap and actually put your arm out and actually help people. And I've realized that in Canada and North America, if you want to grow and get big, you can actually cooperate with people. So, it's just, being honest with you, Joe, it's just a great place to be. It's just a great place to bring your kids up. I've found that because of what I've done with Muay Thai World Cup, there is no competition. So I'm very much a a boat in the ocean on my own, which means I can grow. So I love that. You know, I love that.
And how's the local Muay Thai scene there at the moment? I mean, because traditionally, like, Canada isn't known for its Muay Thai. But how is it at the moment? How's it coming along?
Improved. It's improved. Like, for example, the three finalists that we've got in the road to once, we've got the girls, we've got Morgane, who's spends extensive time in Thailand at Khao Samrit Gym, which is my old gym, funny enough. Khao Samrit Gym, she trains up there quite a lot. She's fought in Thailand multiple times. She's a finalist. She's fighting Tyler McClatchy. Tyler McClatchy was in Lion Fight. She's again an IFMA gold medalist herself, so them two girls are fighting. Then you've got the 145 pound division, 65 kilo. You've got Jake Peacock, who's from England actually originally. He's very explosive, he's got a good story. I don't know if you've seen him on the social media feeds. He's got one arm. I don't know if you've seen him.
I've seen him.
He's amazing. He's absolutely amazing.
Great kick stylist. I love your style.
Absolutely. And people think that's, I'll be able to throw a hook at him because he's got one arm. It's not true. So he knows how to move. He's born with that. He's evasive. He's slick. He's a great character. He's got a good story. His opponent's Abdul Wafar, who's come out of nowhere. He's a guy that came over from Africa 5 years ago. He's got one of those stories, you know, like an Ngannou story. So them two are... and he's very strong too. So them two are going to go clashing. Then you've got the weight above 155 pounds, 70.3 kilos, whatever it is. You've got this guy called Cody Jerome, who's a WBC champion, who's got an engine like he's just the fittest man ever. He lives and breathes it. I know people say that all the time, but this guy doesn't even have a cheeseburger. This guy doesn't even have a beer. He lives... You know what I mean? Everything's gluten-free. You know, he's one of those guys, hunts for his food, doesn't buy the
opposite, opposite of me.
opposite of me. And then you've got his opponent, who himself is a First Nation indigenous guy who quit Muay Thai, and then a spot came up in a tournament and quit school for 1 year to do this tournament. And he's not final out semi. So what I'm trying to say is that all these guys, two girls, four guys, they've raised their game. They've invested in themselves. They've got some good experience. They've gone to Thailand. Some of them have gone to the Netherlands to train. Jake went to England, for example. They've invested in themselves. They haven't just relied on the sources of Canadian Muay Thai. They've invested in themselves. They've gone out. They've got some valuable experience, and now they're going to put it onto a show.
And you know what's brilliant about that is these guys investing in themselves. They're able to bring their, you know, like just like the old days when Aussies or the English used to go to Thailand, they're able to bring that knowledge back and bring it back to the local community. You know, that's one of those fantastic things about, you know, all these young guys going in, investing themselves and bridging the gap,
I think the problem is that these young kids coming through, they want to be entrepreneurs, you know, they want to be, they look at Liam Harrison and go, right, he's got a million followers, I could be that. They're forgetting Liam Harrison's had 120 fights, you know, like, they're forgetting that he fought in these shitty shows with smoke-filled arenas. And then, like you said, those, you know, province shows, you know, and they just put a ring up in front of a Buddhist temple or something. You know, you've got to do all those sort of things. And I think a lot of people want to fast track that, but you have to spend on yourself. I've always said fighting's gambling, right? You've got to roll the dice on yourself if you generally believe in yourself. But with that, you've got to invest in yourself. Nothing comes for free. You'll get to a stage where, if you're good enough and you believe in yourself, things will, you know, become cheaper. But you still always have to invest in yourself. I always tell people that. Look at Conor McGregor. You don't think he doesn't pay his coaches money? You know, you think he's still investing in himself. but those six finalists, they've generally raised the bar for themselves. and they've gone out, they've spread their wings, they've got some super experience, and they're going to bring that A game.
To kind of wrap this up, where can people see the Muay Thai World Cup and the Road to One series?
Obviously social media, so it's Muay Thai World Cup on Instagram and Facebook page, and then we've got our own website, muaythaiworldcup.com, which has the pay-per-view on there too. And like I said, it's a full show. We've got amateurs going through, then we've got pros, we've got a WBC international fight, which is a Canadian standout called Mark McKinnon, who's a bit of a legend in Canada. He's going to fight Chip Pollard, who's actually in Thailand at the moment. Training George Mann, actually, at the moment in Thailand.
PK, yeah?
Yeah, that's it. So he's training for they're going to be competing for the WBC International Cruiserweight title. Mm-hmm. And that's the undercard. And then, of course, you've got the main three finalists. So it's an action-packed night.
Well, that's awesome. You know, Kieran, thank you so much for your time.
No, thank you.
You know, I really appreciate you breaking things down about Canadian and the North American scene at the moment. It's great to hear, you know, promoters like yourself, as we like, not a buzzword, bridging the gap. But, you know, I think it's really important that the work that, you know, you guys are doing over there, especially bringing exposure to this beautiful sport over there, where it wasn't so popular before and now is starting to gain some momentum. So I really appreciate your time, Kieran. Where can people find you on social media?
Just put my name in, Kieran Keddle. I'm on Facebook and Instagram. I was on Twitter, but Twitter is a hard, it's a funny platform, let's put it that way. But yeah, so find me on those things. And thank you, by the way, for bringing me on. And I'll definitely be seeing you next year because I'm at the WBC festivals for the games. Oh. And then, of course, the three guys that get signed, I'm going to be their manager, so I'll be there too. So I'm looking forward to seeing you.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much. This is Chok Muay Chats, episode 12. And here with Kieran Keddle, promoter, trainer, and just all-round good guy. So thank you, mate.
Thank you very much. Take care.
All right. Take care. Thank you, buddy.
Yeah. Bye.
See ya. Bye.